cyffredin enw fi, fi ydi cydlynydd celfa iechyd efo bwrdd iechyd cwmta organwg. At Ysbyty y Seren, we've developed a model of good practice of holistic, creative healthcare for patients and for staff.
We built an amazing dynamic where the women felt that that space was really valuable to express things that they might not have felt comfortable expressing in other places. And some of the feedback from that was through their writing. They felt they could be really, really honest, and they felt that what they wrote and what they wanted to share was valued.
Good morning, my name's Melanie Watton. I'm Exhibitions Coordinator for the Hearth Gallery at University Hospital Llandoch.
The health charity has worked with Rubicon Dance since 2010 to develop a programme to enhance the lives of elderly patients with a range of conditions. It improves both mobility and a sense of well-being.
The Armchair is a group that have been with us for around about 2 years, and it's set up to work with participants and carers with early onset memory loss.
Particularly attractive because in her teenage years she was hoping to become part of a theatre company in some way.
It opens up all sorts of doors and avenues for people.
To lose one parent may be regarded as misfortune. To lose both sounds like carelessness.
Lockdown, I've realised that happiness is a very precious thing. I've seen my mum smile when I make a joke, my brother laugh when I do something stupid, and I've heard my friends laugh over the phone.
Remarkable moment of my life.
Good morning, everyone, and welcome to today's session. My name is Helen Howson. I'm the director of the Bevan Commission, and I'm delighted to welcome you all here on a delightfully sunny day after a rather very wet day yesterday. So welcome, everyone. Today's session, A Greener Wales, Working Towards Sustainable NHS, is a really interesting concept for us to start to really think about and to think about very much more seriously. We've all heard lots of facts, and I just got a few facts I'd like to share with you by way of an introduction. The climate emergency is recognised as the greatest threat of the 21st century, despite the fact that we think that COVID is and others are also there. Almost 25% of deaths can be prevented by tackling environmental drivers of poor health. And if global healthcare sector was a country, it would be a fifth biggest climate polluter. The NHS Wales Decarbonisation Strategic Plan was published this year and aims to be a net zero public sector by 2030. That's not far away. And today we'd really like to understand more from people who have already been doing work in this area, but also from others, and hopefully to inspire more action and create that action across Wales, whether it be within the NHS or with our communities and other partners. Facts sometimes become immune. We've heard those facts many times. We hear them time and again, and sometimes things go over our heads. What today is about is trying to make sure that we now look at this and we grab it and we take things forward. So we want today to be a trigger. We want to see this wave of action. We want today to be helping us create ideas, stimulate thinking, and develop a whole approach across Wales. So the session today will explore ways in which NHS Wales is working towards having a positive impact on our environment and inbred sustainability within its culture. So it's not seen as an add-on, it's seen as an important part of its day-to-day work. The Bevan Commission sees sustainability and the whole issue around how do we sustain our health and care system as part of a greener environment, as part of its priorities in working forward over the next 5 years. And we will continue to look at how we may contribute to this agenda. So we want NHS Wales to think about how being part of the solution, it can actually contribute significantly to this agenda. We have an excellent agenda set out today with a number of speakers. Unfortunately, we have an apology from one of our speakers who is ill. And we want to apologise for Claire Pittman of NRW, Natural Resources Wales. Claire, unfortunately, is ill, but she wanted to send a message. And the big message was a huge thank you to the NHS staff for all the work that they've been doing through the pandemic. So we will be consolidating probably a little earlier today, but I'm sure if any of you wanted to contact Claire, she'd be delighted subsequently to talk to you about that. So today's speakers then, we have Dr. Stacey Harris, we have Dr. Tom Downs, and we have Caitlin Hamlett. I'm going to introduce first of all the first speaker, Stacey. Stacey is a paediatric doctor and has an enthusiasm for quality improvement, wellbeing, and medical education. And she co-founded the Paediatric Medical Education podcast, Dragon Bites. Stacey has a really keen interest and enthusiasm for planetary health, and was able to take up recently a post for a Welsh Clinical Leadership Fellowship in sustainable healthcare to help focus her enthusiasm around this and to be able to allow her to explore in further detail how she may, and with others, explore this further. She sits on and is an active member of the Green Wales Network and the Board for Decarbonising NHS Wales. So Stacey's going to kick us off, and we look forward to her presentation. Thank you, Stacey.
Thank you, Helen, and thank you to the NHS Wales Confederation for the opportunity to speak today. Please bear with me. I have COVID at the moment and I'm not feeling 100%. Next slide, please. So I wanted to set the scene of why I'm here speaking to you today. And as a globally responsible nation, in our mostly privileged Western lives, it can be difficult to see the effects of climate change and how it's affecting people globally and in our most vulnerable communities. So I wanted to just start with this short video just to give an insight. So Claudia, I can't hear anything. I think you might need to.
But I think that most people don't know that there's hundreds of studies now connecting the dots between climate change and human health, and that's a big concern. Climate change is fueling more frequent and more intense and longer lasting heat waves. And that heat is not just an inconvenience to people, it kills people. Some of the people who are most vulnerable to that extreme heat include children and older adults and households that are economically disadvantaged. And that's not just a few people, that amounts to many millions of people in the US. Another concern is air pollution. The warmer temperatures are, the higher the concentration of some really important air pollutants. Breathing ground-level ozone smog can irritate your eyes and your throat and really damage your lungs and airways. There are other kinds of air pollutants that are also affected by climate change. Take the kind of pollens that can make allergy symptoms much, much worse, or even trigger an asthma attack. The longer our warm weather seasons, the more pollen is produced in the air. So it's like a double whammy for health, ozone smog and pollen. There's another way, a third way that climate change is affecting people's health, and that's insects and the illnesses that they can carry, like dengue fever, like West Nile virus, like Zika virus that are carried by mosquitoes, and Lyme disease that's carried by certain kinds of ticks. The thing is, people don't think often about how much those illnesses caused by climate change cost, and not just in human suffering and pain and illness, but in dollars and cents. It's big dollars. NRDC looked at just six of those kind of events that have occurred very recently: a wildfire episode, a hurricane season, a flooding episode, a West Nile virus outbreak, an air pollution episode, a heat wave, and found that it cost over $14 billion just to people's health. Those are costs that we don't think about, and we need to. I guess my hope as a scientist who studies climate change and health is not that people will get super bummed out listening to all of these effects, but that they'll be energized and demand preparedness and demand cleaner energy and demand building healthier and more secure communities for their children's future.
Next slide, please, Claudia. So climate change directly affects the health of us by increasing the warmer temperatures, more extreme weather events, and the effects of sea level rise. And these events disrupt our systems, for example, can destroy homes, medical facilities, and other essential services. And more than half of the world's population lives within 60 kilometers of the sea. And that includes Cardiff. This can impede our ability to produce food, damages our infrastructure, and communities may need to relocate. It can lead to poor nutrition in children, a reduction in work capacity, and impacts mental health as well. And all of these effects are more likely to affect those who are most vulnerable in our society. So children and older people, those in socio and economic deprivation, those with disabilities or in ethnic minority groups. And climate change also disrupts the very ecosystems we rely on to survive. Like it said in the video, it can cause the lengthened pollen season, a change in disease transmission. And this again will affect the most vulnerable in our society. A World Health Organization assessment, taking into account only a proportion of the possible health impacts and assuming continued economic growth and health progress, concluded that climate change is expected to cause approximately 250,000 additional deaths per year between 2030 and 2050. That's 38,000 due to heat exposure in the elderly, 48,000 to diarrhea, 60,000 to malaria, and 95,000 to childhood undernutrition. Can I have the next slide, please? This world map always staggers me whenever I see it. At the top are the nations who are mainly responsible for the global warming and the change in the climate. And at the bottom shows those who are affected and dying from the effect. This is a global, racial, social and intergenerational justice issue. Next slide. So in 2009, The Lancet reported that climate change is the biggest global health threat in the 21st century. And it has the potential to undermine the last 50 years of global health gains in public health. But the climate emergency is a public health emergency, but the healthcare sector itself contributes to the problem. Promoting health is at the heart of what we do, but the irony is, in the process of providing healthcare, we're causing harm to the environment, and in so in turn, human health, and we're missing the bigger picture. There are very few industries who have to directly deal with the outcome of their emissions. Next slide, please. The healthcare system affects the environment in many ways. If the global healthcare sector were a country, it would be the fifth largest greenhouse gas emitter on the planet. The carbon footprint of NHS Wales is over 1 million tonnes of CO2 equivalent. Health systems consume enormous quantities of materials, energies, chemicals, and water, and they produce vast amounts of waste. Much of it is toxic. It contributes to air pollution, and our hospitals, despite the name, are pretty inhospitable to nature and biodiversity. Next slide. So this is my story. So I'm a paediatric doctor, and my impact on the world came to light to me when my future generations came into the world. I was doing all that I could at home to become more environmentally friendly, but feeling frustrated. And I was inspired by one little girl in another country called Greta Thunberg. And I joined local school children who felt so strongly that they were willing to give up the privilege of their schooling to show they cared and asked for action. And I, among other healthcare professionals, get moral injury in work often, seeing all the waste and the single-use plastic, just to name one thing. And I realised that I could do more professionally to change the situation than I could do in my personal life. Next slide. There's not just the future, there's a series of possible futures, and we have the power to change our future. Next slide. So enough about how sort of bad climate change is. Climate change is not just the greatest health threat, it's also the greatest health opportunity of the century. Millions of lives can be saved from the health benefits of more ambitious climate action. If health is included in all climate policies in the UK by 2040, this would prevent thousands of deaths every year, up to 6,000 deaths from reducing air pollution, 100,000 deaths from improving diet, and 38,000 from increased physical activity. A more efficient healthcare system can have a significant contribution to the carbon reductions required in the Paris Agreement and the UN Sustainable Development Goals. And as healthcare professionals, we cannot stand on the sidelines. We have a duty to our patients, community, and our life support system. Next slide. It can feel hopeless sometimes, but there is plenty that we can do. Next slide. There's sustainable healthcare. Sustainable healthcare is care that's delivered in a way that does not adversely affect the health of the population and does not use resources in a way that prevents tomorrow's health professionals from providing care. It's an holistic approach. It's not just about decarbonisation, but also addressing other waste streams such as water and air pollution, which contribute to poor health. It considers how we deliver healthcare today without compromising the health of the future. And climate smart healthcare also challenges us to safeguard our patients against environmental risks of climate change through adaptation and mitigation. Next slide. Sustainable healthcare pivots around these four principles: prevention, so promoting health and preventing disease by tackling the causes of illness and inequalities; self-care, empowering patients to take a greater role in managing their own health and healthcare; lean pathways, streamlining care pathways to minimize wasteful activities; and low carbon alternatives, so So prioritising treatments and technologies with a lower environmental impact. Next slide, please. At Green Health Wales, which is a grassroots network of healthcare professionals across Wales who recognise that the climate and ecological emergency is a health emergency, we have a broad strategy to deliver sustainable healthcare in Wales through learn, connect and transform. Next slide, please. And when it comes to learning, we have a vision that every healthcare professional is empowered with the knowledge of sustainable healthcare and the knowledge of how to practice sustainably through sustainable quality improvement. Next slide, please. And click again. The aim of sustainable quality improvement is to deliver care in a way that maximises positive health outcomes and avoids both financial waste and harmful environmental impacts while adding social value at every opportunity. The triple bottom line. Next slide, please. Wales has recognised the climate emergency and has committed to be a carbon neutral public sector by 2030. And it's published the NHS decarbonisation strategy in March this year and has recently instated a programme board, which I sit on with many others from all across Wales. NHS. Next slide. Thank you. So when we're studying the system, the carbon hotspots are different in different parts of the NHS. For example, in acute services, the hotspots are in the building and energy, as well as medical equipment and instruments. But in primary care, the hotspots are in pharmaceuticals. Next slide, please. And when the carbon footprint's broken down according to the source, it can help us with where to focus. And this graph is from NHS England, but it's likely to be similar for Wales. And you can see that some areas we have direct control over and can change, and others we come from our supply chain, which we can still influence. Next slide. This very important and interesting graph comes from the Sustainable Development Unit Health Check in 2016. And it shows actions that are needed to meet the carbon reduction commitments. The purple are global and national actions, and the greener healthcare sector actions. And the white gap shows the things that we don't actually know how we're going to do it yet. And this requires innovation. And innovation is not just about new products, but about new processes. And we heard about many of the exciting innovations happening in Wales yesterday at the lecture series. And so many innovative practices have come as a result of the pandemic. So let's keep ahead of the curve and innovate solutions to reduce carbon emissions. Next slide, please. So one thing that we can do is become more carbon literate. And this is a really good book by Mark Berners-Lee, and it gives a really good flavor of the carbon footprint of lots of different things. Next slide. Inhalers, for example, are around 3.5 to 5% of the NHS's carbon footprint, and different inhalers have different carbon footprints. One of the most commonly used inhalers is Ventolin, which is the top one, and it has a staggering carbon footprint equivalent to 175 miles in a car. But if we swap to an inhaler with fewer environmentally damaging hydrofluorocarbons inside, but the same amount of the drug, then we can halve the carbon footprint. And again, with dry powdered inhalers, the carbon footprint is pretty small. And you times this by the population that are using them, and you can make massive carbon savings as well as money as well. Next slide. The Centre for Sustainable Healthcare offers lots of different sustainability courses about health and healthcare to support efforts and provides a framework to create change. They have virtual workshops, and they're a great place to meet other healthcare professionals who are passionate about making healthcare sustainable. And there's also a plethora of learning resources on the Green Health Wales website if you'd like to check it out. Next slide. So connect. So Tom Downs will be speaking about the amazing work that he's been doing connecting and networking across Wales. And this connecting and networking and collaborating is so important to this agenda. Next slide. And again, next slide. Okay, so we can all do things personally to reduce our carbon footprint at home, like, reducing the flights that we take, or no flights at all, changing our energy usage and things like that. But as healthcare professionals, we are one of the most trusted people in society, and we have a massive role in modelling change and influencing the wider population. We have billions of pounds of purchasing power, and NHS Wales is the largest public sector organisation in Wales and has a key role in delivering this change. To achieve carbon neutrality by 2040, we need to transform our approach to healthcare. The healthcare community needs to be informed about how we can best decarbonise the delivery of healthcare and mitigate against our carbon footprint. As such a large employer, the healthcare community is also an anchor for health and wellbeing, with a mission to heal and do no harm. And the commitment and dedication of healthcare staff means that health can be at the forefront of our approach in tackling the climate emergency. Next slide, please. Next slide, please. So we all have different spheres of influence, and it's important to think about these. So we might be different healthcare staff, we might work in different specialties, on clinical boards, maybe in medical education, or even in the Welsh government. And it's important to talk about it, climate change and sustainability, and how we can transform and change and do things about it as much as we can. And we can be the unstoppable change, movement for change. Next slide, please. Transform. So it's transformation. So there's already amazing innovation and transformation happening around Wales, whether it be work on anaesthetic gases, nitrous oxide, waste streams, or digital care pathways. And I know that Tom will be going into some more examples of projects later in the session, so I don't want to steal his thunder. Next slide, please. And again, please. So we dream of changing to a sustainable healthcare, where we go from feeding children in hospital frozen factory farm chicken goujons and chips thrown from halfway around the world, to food locally produced and cooked from scratch on site, to hospitals inhospitable to wildlife and biodiversity, to where it can thrive. And so we're, and so do the people that use it. Everyone can benefit from and thrive from the benefits of green space and health, where healthcare waste is reduced to its absolute minimum, where we go from 20 diesel ambulances chugging outside emergency departments and patients smoking as staff and vulnerable patients try to enter the hospital, to clean, healthier surrounding the hospital, a sanctuary for patients and staff, a healthcare system that is low carbon, resilient and equitable. Next slide, please. To achieve the massive scale transformation in our NHS service needs, it's going to require massive collaboration and cooperation and willpower. Next slide, please. From life sciences, clinical teams, procurement, local authorities, health boards, Welsh government, everybody. I've just listed a few here. It really is going to be a big task. Next slide, please. So this is a statement from Andrew Goodall from the NHS Wales COVID-19 Innovation and Transformation Study. And during a crisis, people often do new and innovative things that they've never done before. We look at issues differently and take instinctive action that challenges the status quo. In doing so, we break down barriers and accelerate change in how services are delivered. We've seen many such examples of innovative practice during the COVID-19 pandemic response. And it's essential to capture this and ensure that we take the opportunity to learn the valuable lessons arising as a result. So let's use this momentum for the climate emergency as well. Next slide. So another really important thing that we need to do is to spread and scale the amazing work that's going on in Wales and at pace, because we have a lot of work to do in a very short period of time. Next slide, please. So 2020 has been dominated by COVID-19 and is the most pressing health emergency facing us. But undoubtedly, climate change poses the most profound long-term threat to the health of the nation. Thank you. Helen, you're
Thank you, Stacey, and for persevering with us today. We know you're not feeling your best, but that was an absolutely fantastic presentation, setting out that widest context for us all to understand the issues that we face, the challenges, but also those fantastic opportunities. And we will hear more of those now from Tom as we move on. But just to let everybody know, we're going to take questions after all three speakers have spoken. And so please save them up and put them on the chat as well, by all means. But we're going to do a final round of Q&A session at the end. Stacey, thank you for that. We had a really excellent introduction to, as I say, not only the opportunities, but some of those challenges. And we'll come back and unpack perhaps how and in what ways we can do that, and we can work together to achieve that. So I'm going to move on to, thank you for that, Stacey. I'm going to move on to Tom now. And Tom and I know each other of old. I was Tom's mentor when he first became a Bevan exemplar with a really great idea about a green hospital. Tom was a junior doctor at the time. He's moved on, but he was an F1 at the time, with great enthusiasm, passion, and commitment, which is what we know you need to drive change forward. He is very keen to progress his work and to share his ideas. And what he actually did was to develop the concept of a green hospital and look at how that can be extended and spread across in that case it was Betsy Cadwaladr, but we are looking at opportunities around how that can be extended across Wales. So Tom is going to be speaking on his work. He's going to include some case studies and the green groups and how that might be spread and learned across Wales. So Tom, over to you.
Thank you, Helen. So my name's Tom, I'm a junior doctor and I've been a Bevan exemplar, and as Helen said, she's been my mentor for my project. So we've heard a bit about the background. Climate change is the greatest health threat of this century. And if the global healthcare sector were a country, it would be the fifth biggest climate polluter. I was aware of this when I was graduating from Cardiff Medical School in 2019. I felt like I was graduating in the midst of the climate emergency. I was anxious and quite overwhelmed about what I knew about the climate crisis, its impact on health, and also the impact that we have on the environment through healthcare. I wanted to see if there was something I could do to improve environmental sustainability, but it was quite hard to know where to start. So I was encouraged by colleagues in Spitty Gwynedd and Bangor to apply for a project with the Bevan Commission. And my project was titled Making the Connections to Improve the Environmental Sustainability at Our Hospital. So this started off as conversations with other junior doctors. What we did initially was set up a stall outside the canteen, and we collected all the ideas from staff about what we could do. And what was really surprising is the level of interest and engagement from staff. And this led to the formation of our green group in Spitty Gwynedd. This is a pre-COVID meeting, but now there are well over 100 members of our green group. So we focus on power sharing. All members of staff are welcome, whether they have a clinical or non-clinical role, whether they're a senior member of staff or a junior member of staff. And we had some committee roles for organisational purposes. And these committee members were made up of junior members of staff. And that included Gwen, another foundation doctor, Yasmina, a pharmacist, Lewis, a junior doctor, and myself. So it took us a while to figure out how was the best way that we could organise ourselves. And this is what we came up with: connect, learn and transform. So connect, we need to make connections across the hospital, work collaboratively with all of the departments and engage with external stakeholders on the issue. we need to learn and educate ourselves as individuals working in healthcare, but also to provide informative and educational resources for others. And finally, we need to transform, we need to take real action, and we need to implement sustainability projects that can have a real measurable impact. So connect, what things have we been doing to connect as the Green Group in Ysbyty Gwynedd? Well, we didn't just engage across the hospital, but we engaged with communities and the third sector. We featured in the NHS Sustainability Impact Report for staff engagement and pleased that we were able to be a case study for the Future Generation Commissioner of Wales. It also meant that having this group, that staff ideas could then feed into the decarbonisation strategy for NHS Wales. Learn. So locally, we've produced educational resources, given grand rounds and done departmental talks. And some have done, included sustainability as the main theme for their governance meeting in some departments. And we've had a notice board on the corridor. We've done community engagement with TV and radio interviews on the importance of sustainable COVID recovery and decarbonising healthcare. We've also been learning ourselves, and we've had a shared calendar of upcoming sustainable healthcare webinars, events, and we've done a journal club. But personally, I've also been learning. I've had the mentorship and support from the Bevan Commissioner's Exemplar, and this year we were able to attend the Spread and Scale Academy to help develop our ideas as a team. So initially we started with a project bank, but this became six streams for areas of action. This includes clinical projects, food, energy, waste, transport, and biodiversity. So what sort of things have we been doing in those areas? So in terms of clinical projects, there's been work on anaesthetic gases, inhalers, nitrous oxide, and procurement in pharmacy. Biodiversity, there's been a launch of a health walk from the hospital to the local meadows, and the Wildlife Trust now meets groups outside the front of the hospital to take them to that and benefit from the health and wellbeing of nature. There are now planters outside the doctor's accommodation for them to relax and enjoy. There's flowers outside the front of the hospital, and there's a meadow plant to improve biodiversity on hospital site. There's 20 trees now to be planted in Ysbyty Gwynedd site next month as part of World Mental Health Day. And there's work linking mental health patients with upkeep of the gardens for therapeutic benefit. In terms of food, dietitian Manon has been working on vegan and vegetarian options for the canteen, and consultant geriatrician Dr. Bates has been working on local food sourcing with local growers. In terms of waste, we've changed to recycled paper. We've been looking at reusable PPE and reusable mask pilots, and these have had some really positive feedback. For the reusable gowns, these can be washed up to 75 times, and that results in both environmental and cost savings. And the pharmacy department are looking at sending old BNFs abroad for reuse. In terms of transport, we've been highlighting active travel routes, and there's work going on electrifying the fleet and putting in electric car charging points. For World Car Free Day, the anaesthetic department had quite a fun idea, and they proposed a competition with the hospital departments who can do the most green miles in cycling to the hospital. The Green Group's also planning a Green Health Week to coincide with COP26. So that is the big climate change conference, which is happening in Glasgow this year. They're looking at doing a theme every day. So for example, they're looking at doing an Ecosia competition. So that's a search browser, similar to Google, but when you're searching, it plants trees, doing a hospital litter pick, a climate meal deal in the canteen, and a green ward competition. So in terms of some of the measurable impacts that people have had, the anaesthetic department has done a good job keeping track of some of the numbers, and they've changed from desflurane, which is an anaesthetic gas with a high global warming potential, 3,000 times that of carbon dioxide, and they've switched to sevoflurane, which has a similar clinical effect but a lower global warming potential. That's resulted in significant savings, over 10,000 kilograms of CO2 equivalent per month, which is equivalent of driving your car over 25,000 miles or flying to New York over 9 times. These are some graphs that show over time the amount of engagement and transformation that have been happening in the green group, as well as some of the change that has been delivered. So I think one of the most important things is working as a team and group working. I think that can be highlighted particularly when you look at the breakdown of the carbon footprint for NHS Wales. As Stacey has already said, that's over 1 million tonnes of CO2 equivalent. And if we look at where those hotspots are for NHS Wales, looking at the carbon footprint from 2018 and 19, the areas are across the board. That also includes things that we have control over in terms of clinical projects. So, you know, drugs and pharmaceuticals make up 23%, medical equipment and supplies 11%. And then that also includes transport and how we think about powering our hospitals. So as well as the practical importance of working in a team for decarbonisation, it's also been really important that we've been able to share the workload and that staff have benefited from this sense of community. We've had some feedback from members of the Green Group, and they've said that it's helped them identify where their profession can make an impact on the environment and where they can change their practice. And they've also been able to align their values with other people, and they felt reassured that other people can share the same concerns for the environment that they do. And it's also helped them manage anxiety in terms of anxiety during the pandemic, but also anxiety related to the environment. And it's helped people learn that they can do something no matter who they are. So we did go to the Spread and Scale Academy. And after gaining some skills and confidence there, we have been supporting the other two hospital sites in Betsy Cadwaladr to develop their own green groups. So now we've got Isbiti Glencluid and Exbiti and Wrexham Mailer green groups as well. So we were also hoping to have a webinar, we're hosting a webinar of how to adopt a green group in the week of COP26 as well. So I reached out to the green groups, just the green groups to see how they've been getting on. And this is feedback that I had from Wrexham. And there's lots of enthusiasm and there's already some ongoing projects which include biodiversity, nitrous oxide and waste. We then presented to the health board on the topic, and because they noticed that this was such a high priority for staff in the health board, they're now looking at adopting a new value for the health board called Protect Our Children's Future. This was designed by by the daughter of one of the consultant anaesthetists, Carson, and it's a tree holding a baby. So being a Bevan Exemplar is not what I imagined I would have been doing as working as a new doctor, but I have really enjoyed working with the Green Group and also working as Bevan Exemplar. It's been really important for me to be able to have that support and mentorship and confidence and go ahead to actually take some initiative and implement my ideas and projects. And it's been really inspiring to see the work happening from my colleagues. It has been a challenge because as a junior doctor, I didn't have any protected time, and all the time working on this has been voluntary. But what has been key is harnessing the enthusiasm, skills and expertise of my colleagues. And as we were able to share the workload, we were able to keep work going throughout the pandemic. Having the group also meant that we were able to identify many new leaders in our hospital who may have otherwise have gone under the radar. And I've really been inspired by them and their dedication. So that's like Yasmina, Gwen, and many others. There's still a lot of work to be done. And obviously I can't take credit for a lot of the work which I've just, and projects that I've just mentioned, because that's really been a team effort. And I was really pleased to see as well that this is a priority for the Bevan Commission as well. And their cohort of Bevan Commission exemplars for cohort 7 is doing things differently for a prudent and sustainable recovery. So we didn't just stop there, and we realised that the work across Wales wasn't all so joined up. So we collaborated with some colleagues in Cardiff and they launched Green Health Wales. So Green Health Wales is a network for sustainable healthcare in Wales. It's the culmination of individuals and employees coming together across Wales, and it's open to anyone and it's employee led. So we at the moment, we do not sit anywhere. We see ourselves as self-organising. Our website acts as a platform for people, and they can connect, they can use the website to connect by their location or their specialty. And then we've also got resources on there where people can learn more, and they can also upload resources themselves. And it also acts as a platform for people to put up their projects and ideas so they can be more easily adopted and spread across Wales. So we had our launch event on the 29th of June, and we're really pleased to have engagement from the health boards. The CEO of NHS Wales attended, as well as the Future Generations Commissioner. And we were also able to highlight some of the good work happening all the way across Wales. So as part of Green Health Wales, there's also national networks that we've been able to connect with. So some of those include the Welsh Environmental and Aesthetic Network and Greener Practice Wales for GPs. And the Welsh Environmental and Aesthetic Network are going to the Spread and Scale Academy, and they hope to support other specialties to develop their own networks for improving sustainability in Wales. These are the principles for the Green Group. And I think it's important to highlight that it's not just about decarbonisation, but also about resilience, regeneration, and justice. And these are important principles for our response to the climate emergency. The Future Generations Commission has also helped link these to their wellbeing goals. So just coming together with people with a shared interest can be quite powerful, not only for adopting and spreading ideas, but also it can help raise the profile of a particular issue. We were approached by Cardiff and Vale Health Board to submit some recommendations from Green Health Wales to the Sixth Synod. And these included ensuring a healthy climate is central to COVID-19 recovery, because a stable climate is a fundamental determinant of health. You could argue that limiting global temperature rise to 1.5 degrees is one of the most important public health goals. Optimise the health co-benefits of climate action, because tackling climate change prevents ill health caused by non-communicable diseases, save lives from reduced air pollution, improving diet, increased physical activity, and improved housing. The reduced healthcare costs from implementing such policies means that the overall economic benefit from them outweighs any initial costs. Restore the foundation of human health, nature. And this was recognised important by the Chief Medical Officer to help prevent pandemics by looking at the intersections of animal, human and environmental health as part of sustainable development in Wales. We need to also build health resilience to climate change. Health facilities must be a safe haven in the storm of climate change. But at the moment, this isn't always the case. In London, patients were evacuated during flooding, And in Wales, our hospitals can be at risk of overheating during heat waves. We also need to prioritise public health and prevention. And it's really important to be guided by a prudent healthcare approach, working in co-production with others, caring for those with the greatest health need first, doing no harm and using evidence best practice. I think those should be fundamental to how we respond to climate change. We also should, I think the Welsh Government should utilise healthcare to lead by example, because frontline health workers have demonstrated the ability that they can focus on multiple priorities at once, being on the front lines of the pandemic while also working to tackle the climate and nature emergencies. We need to then mobilise and support the health community on this, because otherwise they may risk being overwhelmed. We need to rethink health finances and think how we can move to measuring success in terms of health and well-being as a long-term measure. We also need to develop the leadership for decarbonising healthcare, and we need to put the approach to healthcare at the heart of our decarbonisation plans. A lot of work can be done voluntary, as we've seen, but the capacity for staff to act must be there. There's opportunity here for people to be in post to help coordinate the work, but essentially we also need people in post who can monitor and govern progress against our targets. We also need to think long-term and invest in the future in planetary health. It's really important to involve young people's voices, because this will affect them the most. And we also need to have transdisciplinary research for complex problems, such as the climate and nature emergencies. And we need to be measuring the health co-benefits of the actions that are being taken, so that over time we can maximise those health benefits. So how can we create a greener Wales? So what would be good is, you know, anybody can come and join the Green Health Wales community. You can connect either locally or by your specialty, and you can learn more and join one of our upcoming events, or transform and you can be part of a Green Health Week in the run-up to COP26 at your hospital. Thank you.
Tom, what a fabulous achievement. You must be very proud. I'm very proud of you. And in just a 12-month period, you took a concept, you used your enthusiasm, you used your networks to really make a difference. And what we're seeing is that enthusiasm and that motivation now being adopted and spread across Wales. So we'll come back to you with some more specific questions, but congratulations and well done for everything that you've done over and above your day job. And I think, you know, for most of us, it's hard doing a day-to-day job and doing part of your training, but I think it just goes to demonstrate the commitment and the extent to which commitment and enthusiasm has to play is really significant. So thank you very much, and we'll come back with some questions shortly. I'd like to move on and introduce Caitlin Hamlett now. Caitlin is the sustainability manager for NHS Scotland. She has experience in developing environmental policy and has led climate change initiatives and developments for over the last 6 years. She's a member of the board of Green Exercise and Partnerships, and also has an interest in addressing the issues between environment and inequality. So Caitlin, we'd love to hear from you and from Scotland. And can I just say a welcome to Wales on behalf of everyone here today. So Stacey, over to you.
Thank you so much, Helen. It's an absolute joy to be here from my kitchen just outside Edinburgh. Hello, everyone. And gosh, what an act to follow. That was just so inspiring, Tom and Stacey. really enjoyed hearing about what's happening in Wales and working more closely together as well. So my name is Caitlin, as Helen said. I'm a member of a small team up here in Scotland. There's five of us. Two members of that team are actually seconded in. We work closely with the environment sector up here. We have Anne, who is a lead on green space and the arts. So it was just fantastic to hear about what you're doing down there with the arts as well, and how important that is. And we also have Matilda, who is seconded to us from Sustrans, which is an active travel organisation. So between five of us, I'm just going to talk a little bit today about what we do as a team, the sorts of things that are happening up in Scotland, and what we're doing in the lead up to COP26 as well. Thank you, Claudia. Next slide. So a little bit of the legal political context. Obviously up here, the Scottish Government declared a climate emergency in 2019. NHS Scotland thought long and hard about declaring a climate emergency ourselves. So shortly after that, we supported that commitment obviously with Scottish Government. And we signed up all of our chief executives to six commitments around the climate emergency, which I'll come on to in a little bit. The main legislation up here is the Climate Change Scotland Act, and it requires that through their functions, public bodies must contribute to climate change mitigation, adaptation, and act sustainably. And the emissions reductions targets have just been changed for anyone who's keeping an eye on what's happening up here. Scottish Government has obviously joined together with the Green Party in Scotland, and so our targets are being brought forward. We are now on a par with NHS Wales because we are looking to decarbonise by 2035. So. Well, actually, I'm saying we're on a par. It's 2035. There's talk about 2030, but 2038 at this moment for hospitals, that could potentially change. Next slide, Claudia. Thank you. So the root of everything that we're doing, Scottish Government and ourselves signed up to the UN Sustainable Development Goals. Everything that we have been doing is focused back on how we can commit to delivering these goals, and looking at sustainability in the whole, as well as the decarbonisation agenda too. Thank you, Claudia. Next slide. The Sustainable Development Goals are closely linked with our National Performance Framework. I say linked, but they're actually embedded within it. So each of our national outcomes reflects the UN SDGs, and that's our way up here of embedding the UN SDGs at a local level. The NHS, we make sure that everything that we're doing aligns with these national outcomes. Thank you, Claudia. Slide. So why does it matter for healthcare? And Stacey just gave such an inspiring presentation about that. Just a few of the facts up here. Obviously, it's the biggest health threat of the 21st century, but as Tom said as well, it's also the biggest health opportunity. Health accounts for 4% of global greenhouse gas emissions. Fuel poverty, a particular issue here in Scotland, costing 80 million per annum. Poor air quality causing 2,000 premature deaths per annum in Scotland. The social costs, rising health inequalities. There are parts up here, for example, in Glasgow, where there are miles between premature deaths and longevity, and that gap has been getting bigger. And then, of course, the climate impacts, which Stacey talked about earlier, on health service delivery and the reputational risks. The picture there at the top right is a recent publication in The Guardian talking about flooding and flood risk. And we did a study that was showing a number of hospitals that are at high risk of flooding. We've had some serious issues already in the last couple of years with flooding in our hospitals. Thank you, Claudia. Next slide. So as I mentioned at the start, just after the climate emergency, our chief executive signed up to these six commitments in Scotland that we will be a net zero organisation by 2045 at the latest. That date has now been brought forward, that all NHS Scotland new buildings and major refurbishments will be designed to have net zero emissions from April of 2020, so that's a work in progress already, that each NHS Scotland board will undertake a climate change risk assessment covering all operational areas and produce a climate change adaptation plan. The transport emissions will be net zero by 2025 for small and medium vehicles, 2030 for our ambulances. The NHS supply chain is going to be reviewed to determine the extent of greenhouse gas emissions. And then we will be working to minimise those impacts. And that each NHS Scotland board will establish a climate change and sustainability governance group. Thank you, Claudia. Next slide. So behind all of this, and I suppose more at grounds level, we developed branding. We worked with GPs, with clinical staff, with primary care staff, with health and facilities staff to develop this sustainability action branding, which was really, it's the banner, a bit like Green Health Wales that we come under up in Scotland. So anyone who wants to get involved in projects and initiatives, this is our sort of central point, is this sustainability action. Within this, we look at these different priority areas, I suppose, these areas of focus. So we cover capital projects, active travel, transport, green space and nature and biodiversity, which are very loosely under our NHS. Under our people, we focus on awareness, welfare, ethical issues, communities and sustainable care. And our planet, we're looking specifically around environmental management, procurement and supply chain, waste, adaptation or resilience to climate change, and of course, greenhouse gases. Thank you, Claudia. This is our team and the services that we provide. As I say, we're a very small team. We're based in Health Facilities Scotland, but we provide a service to all 22 health boards across Scotland, which can often mean one-to-one direct support and producing guidance. And I'll talk a little bit more about these different areas. Thank you, Claudia. I won't go into any detail on these slides, but just to say, we have a lead on energy and water management. We've just started developing what we call net zero route maps for each health board up here. And that picture at the top right is our first zero carbon hospital, which is in the Orkney Islands. So this is also a copy you can see there on the right. That's a cover of one of the first net zero route maps that we've produced, which provides a clear pathway to how we're going to meet our emissions reduction targets. We've also, just to highlight, recently produced a sustainable construction and design guide. It's centred around three themes of circularity and circular economy and climate change and health and well-being. And this guidance, we're hoping, will make a real transformation in how we're delivering healthcare facilities. Thank you, Claudia. Next slide. Resilience, adaptation to climate change, we've developed a tool. We realised that it's so difficult for people who have no background or experience or have never worked with things like the UK CP18 data, the future climate projections. We wanted something that was just for people that had never really looked at these things before, very, very user-friendly. So it's a step-by-step tool for health boards to look at their climate risks. And at the bottom, we've also developed a GIS mapping tool. I think things are always much easier when they're visual, and this tool allows health boards to zoom into their areas. It contains all the climate change projection data. So each health board can look at, for example, their risk of flooding, their risk of overheating in hospitals, how that will affect wards, and can use this to start informing our adaptation plans. Thank you, Claudia. Next slide. This is my, I lead for NHS Scotland Green Space and Biodiversity. It was lovely to hear about the work that's going on in Wales, connecting with the arts as well. We have green space and arts coordinators in some of the health boards. And this has been so key to when we start developing the green space, especially around hospitals and health centres, it's been so key to getting the community involved and getting staff involved. We also put a link in there. We've just produced a report which tells you a little bit more about the NHS Green Space Demonstration Project, and I'll be coming onto that, but there is a link there for the report about all the work that's been done in each individual health board. Thank you, Claudia. Next slide. Environmental management is so key for us. We each health board currently has an environmental management system. This is so important just at the ground level of environmental management, looking at things like anaesthetic gases, as Tom mentioned earlier, the environmental impact of pharmaceuticals. It's looking at pollution and making sure that our hospitals and our healthcare facilities are meeting the highest environmental standards. Thank you, Claudia. And waste and resource efficiency. We, I'm not sure if you have in Wales, but we have a WARPIT, which is very active, which is about sharing any used items, recycling. All staff up here have access to this. And we are also really proactive about circular economy and circular economy projects. Thank you, Claudia. And sustainable procurement and supply chains, such a huge issue and obviously a biggest part of our greenhouse gas emissions. We're working at the moment to measure and to clarify our scope 3 emissions, as they're called, and so that we can start really making some impact and headway. We're in the process at the moment of developing a climate change emergency strategy. And procurement is a big feature of that, to try and get our greenhouse gas emissions down in our supply chain. Thank you, Claudia. Next slide. And transport and active travel as well. As I said, we have someone in the team that's seconded from an organisation up here called SusTrans, who leads on active travel. We've had a huge amount of funding from Scottish Government. So we've been able to implement lots of cycleways in hospitals, pathways, connecting that to green space and connecting it to the arts as well has been really important. We've developed some electrical vehicle charging infrastructure guidance and working with Transport Scotland very closely as well on active travel. Thank you, Claudia. And governance and policy, so key. Each health board up here has a sustainability group, a governance group, which brings together people from across different departments. So we have people working with, we have clinical representatives, people from public health, estates and facilities, the arts coordinators. And that, as Tom said, that's been absolutely essential key for people to really begin to work together on projects. We've developed a sustainability action website as well, which I've highlighted, that's the link to it. So all of the projects are developed into case studies and we put them on that website to really share best practice. There's also resources for staff. Anyone with, at the moment, an NHS email address, and I will check to make sure that that applies to NHS Wales as well, can access a separate resources tab by logging in on the website. And that contains all of our tools, all of our support. We've developed poster templates, sustainability action poster templates, so that staff can develop their own posters, run their own campaigns. And it also provides a forum where people can come and ask questions and get together in network too. Thank you, Claudia. Next slide. So these are the tasks. I'm not going to go into them because I'm sure we'll be able to share the slides afterwards, but these are the tasks that each board are required to do. There's a lot. We are looking at the moment at further resources. Scottish Government have made a commitment to resource this within the boards. We recognise that we can't do it without people. At the moment, there is one dedicated lead in each board on sustainability, but they are quite overwhelmed and they need extra support there. So from everything from reporting on our climate change duties, we do annual reports here to Scottish Government and our emissions, to biodiversity reports. We have a sustainable procurement duty, which we report on annually. This is each board, and then the policy requirements as well. Thank you, Claudia, next slide. So just to finish with, because this is something which I'm absolutely passionate about, this is just a little short film on what we're doing around green space. Thank you.
If you were to become ill, what might you expect from the NHS? Good clinical care, of course, but what else can the NHS provide? What about the buildings we ask people to visit? What about the land around them?
Over recent years, there's been an increasing body of research which has looked at the impact of green exercise on health and wellbeing. And there's now compelling evidence that that improves not only our physical health, but also our emotional and mental health as well. One of the really interesting pieces of research that I came across was actually for even people who were stuck in a hospital bed, if they were able to connect with the outdoors through a kind of good view from their window, showed that actually the recovery times from operations and their use of analgesics and painkillers was very much less.
In response to this growing body of evidence, the NHS Green Space Demonstration Project was established. The project's aims are to explore the options in terms of greening the NHS outdoor estate and to mainstream this thinking across the healthcare sector. With pilot projects already established in many area health boards, the NHS Green Space Demonstration Project shows how high quality, accessible green space can promote positive health outcomes for a range of groups. Patients are already benefiting.
We have several groups that use the garden throughout the week. These include amputee patients who are going through a process of rehabilitation, user groups such as Dundee Association for Mental Health or the Maggie Centre. We get a lot of referrals as well from occupational therapists, from medical practices and from organisations such as employment support.
Stress can play a major part in a cardiac patient's life, and using the green space can help alleviate that.
This initiative isn't only about therapeutic care though. NHS staff are also benefiting from good quality, accessible green space.
You have various woodland walks. Some can take 15 minutes, some can take half an hour. You know, this one you could run in your lunch break. This one, if you're going to a meeting, you could walk through that. It's all about really trying to transport you and trying to take you away.
It's just fantastic because it means if I'm having a day full of meetings, I can nip out and disappear into the woodland for 10 minutes just to clear my head.
The demonstration project is also about providing a green exercise destination to our local communities.
Postle Park is one of the most deprived communities in Scotland, and we were really keen to invest both in terms of the new health centre, but also in terms of the environment. It's quite a harsh environment, and we were really keen to kind of support the development of this community growing space here.
Across the demonstration project, collaboration between the healthcare and environment sectors has brought additional expertise into the management of the outdoor estate.
We in estates and facilities and capital planning have professional expertise, but perhaps not always in the external environment. We do grounds and gardens very well, but when it comes to that master planning, when it comes to the biodiversity, the principles that are involved, it's good to have the experts there.
The NHS Green Space Demonstration Project is also showing how greening the outdoor estate can assist with some of the wider challenges facing the healthcare sector in Scotland. Green space can provide valuable cooling effects for buildings and people, improve air quality around hospitals, and store water, reducing the risk of flooding. An increased understanding of the impact of external design can also result in expensive problems being avoided.
We know that our buildings are being designed to be far more airtight, but the downside of that is the solar gain that we're experiencing and the build-up of temperatures that we're having in nigh on every new build across the NHS Scotland. We've now got evidence that shows for every pound that we spend on green space, we're actually realising over £4 of social and economic benefits from the wider range of sustainability gains.
The NHS Green Space Demonstration Project has shown what can be achieved to enhance the outdoor estate at relatively low cost. But to achieve real change, we need to apply this thinking across the healthcare sector. Together, we can make places which are nurturing of positive health, well-being and resilience.
Across Scotland, we have a wonderful health facilities estate that sits right in the heart of communities, and I would like to see much more opportunity being exploited to promote those facilities for this type of purpose.
Our vision for the future is that green space is built into every investment decision, every new development, every refurbishment across NHS Scotland. For climate change, for biodiversity, but also for the health of our people.
Thank you, Caitlin. Well, yet another inspiring presentation. I think you've kind of completely overwhelmed us there, just seeing the kind of context within which Scotland is operating this and the kind of work that you're doing. Absolutely inspiring. So I'm just going to round up with a few kind of summary points, and I'm going to come to each of you with some questions. There's the chat facility for those people who wish to ask a question. There's a super one from Joe, so I'm pre-warning all of you, at least those in Wales, that we can start with Joe's in the first instance. But just to kind of wrap this and bring this together, I think, you know, what we've heard this morning, the facts are indisputable. They've been indisputable for some time. They are very consistent with a prudent health and care approach, which is based on those four principles that were highlighted by Tom. It's something that the Commission has been recognising for some time and linking with the Learned Society and others to explore what and how we might do that. But certainly it became a theme for our latest call, which was really about doing things differently for a prudent and sustainable recovery. How do we now bring this together? I think, unfortunately, we've also seen the very strong links between health inequalities and the sustainability question. And yes, yesterday, one of our commissioners, Professor Sir Michael Marmot, was reinforcing those health inequalities that we have, particularly that were highlighted in the wake of the COVID that we've seen over the last 18 months. The challenge, I think, that is there for all of us, really, it's about doing things differently. And it's about ensuring that we, at all levels, I think, do things in ways that will change not only what's happening at the grassroots, but I think we've heard very clearly from Caitlin, how Scotland are also reinforcing this through its health and care system, its performance, its delivery nationally and locally. It's about innovation and transformation, supporting that, and certainly the Commission has been supporting innovation and transformation for the last 5-6 years. And we've learned so much about that you have to take people with you. You have to use the inspiration of people across the system at all levels to be part of those, what we call social movements for change. But you can't do this alone. You have to have that wider infrastructure within which this operates. I think the other challenges, and we're starting to see some of this around how do you adopt and spread this? And Tom mentioned that his green group is his work, and many other, for that matter, exemplar pieces of work are taken and developed by enthusiasts. But what we need to do is to take that learning and apply it across Wales, not just in pockets and in silos. We've seen this is about people, this is about enthusiasm, this is about inspirational change, but it's actually something more fundamental. It's about that government, local, national commitment to this across the board. So I think, we've seen huge opportunities and ideas evolved. I'm really interested in and trying to understand how and in what ways we can actually step up the mark here. I noticed, I think it was Caitlin, your call was for 2045. Our call in Wales is for 2030. What have we got? Perhaps 8 years left to really achieve that challenge there. Time is of the essence. There is a lot to do. And I'm going to come to each of you. I'm going to ask you, what do you feel is the biggest challenge to do that? We're against time here, but I'm going to also ask you to highlight what you think is the biggest opportunity. So I'm going to come back with that as a general question. But before I do, so hold up those questions. But before I do, I'm just going to come back with a few specifics on to the individuals first off. I'm going to come back to Stacey. Stacey, you set out that huge, the context and challenge there. What are the early wins? You mentioned inhalers. I mean, I thought your slide, which said inhalers, drugs and surgery were some of the really kind of the heavy ones. The inhalers is possibly an easy win. How do we do that? It seems relatively straightforward when you highlighted it. But, what do we need to do to just tackle that one challenge?
Thank you, Helen. So when it comes to inhalers, that is quite an obvious big win. And this will require, collaboration and cooperation with across the healthcare system, because inhalers are prescribed both by general practitioners, acute paediatricians, acute respiratory physicians, and in the A&E department. There is work going on, which is part of the respiratory implementation group. And it's around changing guidelines initially so that everyone is speaking from the same hymn sheet. Evidence-based changing of practice to in children, young children, to more environmentally friendly metered dose inhalers for younger children. And then actually in adults, dry powdered inhalers often, or if that really isn't suitable for them, more environmentally friendly metered dose inhalers. And you know, that initial work is being carried out with guidelines, but then it's about the real challenge is in that changing of practice and getting the message out. So that will be again through learning and connecting and transforming. So it's important that all healthcare professionals know about sustainable quality improvement, why this is so important and what they can do, and how they can connect and share the good practice, and then how transformation comes as a result. That's in a nutshell.
So if people know, very often people know what they need to do, they know the facts, what is it that might help them just, you know, just make that change? Is there one thing that could happen? Is it about national steerage? Is it about I don't know, is it about professional practice? But how do you actually make some of that stuff happen?
So I actually feel that this isn't particularly well known about. I don't think sustainable healthcare is widespread, and I don't think that many people there's a growing movement, but whenever I speak to people about it, it's like pushing an open door. They went, as soon as they kind of have that knowledge and understanding of, you know, what, why it's so important and what they can do to change, they're very, very willing. I don't think there's any problem for with healthcare staff themselves wanting to change and being able to change, as long as, you know, it's evidence-based and values-based. But what I am finding is that, you know, we really need to resource this. We heard about the structures that they have in Scotland, from the Welsh government, having medical directors on the board, in all of the health boards, having teams in every single health board to be able to deliver this. I think that, you know, that we're really struggling with that. We're most of the work that's done, as you heard from Tom, is being done in healthcare professionals' own time, and they're already stretched with, you know, delivering clinical work as well. So it would be wonderful, and that's why as part of our work with Green Health Wales, we were really keen to speak to the Welsh Government to help them to understand the Green Health Wales priorities, and we're really hoping that as part of this decarbonisation plan, and that we will really be able to get that government backing and get the resource so we can really, really move it forward, because we know what to do, is, you know, but we do need the sort of resource to be able to move forward with it.
Fantastic, thank you for that. And we'll come back to the issue of what we really need, how we can bring this together, in fact, Joe's question. And coming on to Tom next. Tom, really interested, you were a bit of a pioneer, an early pioneer, ploughing the way forward as almost like a lone movement there, and we watched you with great interest as part of the Bevan Commission. How did you build your teams, and how did you remember having the conversation with you about creating others, helping others be part of this with you? How did you do that? And also, my second part of the question is, how do you think we can speed up the rate at which this is adopted and spread across Wales?
Thanks, Helen. So I think, as I said in my presentation, the things that we did was having conversations with people, engaging with people on the ground. I think that's really important, is to start having these conversations with people and not to be afraid of talking about some of these more difficult issues. And actually there are things that we can do to make a difference on them. So then getting a group together, so we had a mailing list of people, and then just sort of reaching out more and more, really, putting up a stall, having a board in the hospital. So all of those things is just a great way to sort of reach out to those people. And what is surprising is that you will find that there's other people, and there will probably be other people who've already done, tried stuff in the past, done things, maybe it didn't quite work. But for me, having that backing of doing the Bevan Commission project, I think the feedback we got from some members of the Green Group was, well, now actually, we're actually getting some momentum. And I think that that's something that people had struggled with in the past, is that they tried these things and then it didn't quite work. So then it just gave them a platform to then bring those ideas back, those projects maybe they'd already started. And then it just gave that place for the momentum to start building.
That's interesting. So that framework and all of that, to just a bit of credibility, something that allows them to legitimize almost, taking forward some of their own ideas and work. And interestingly, I think in Scotland, Caitlin, you have, every health board has a key lead on this. And obviously that's an important point of contact and maybe something that we can kind of build on here in Wales. Really, really interesting there. But you also mentioned the it built and it drew out new leaders, Tom. And I think, you know, clearly we've seen your leadership skills develop and you become a leader in your field, but you also identified others who came forward.
Yeah, definitely. I think there's a lot of other people who've come forward as leaders. So, and obviously as a junior doctor, it's not possible to put that amount of time in. So it has to be a team effort. So people were stepping up and, you know, taking on the responsibility. So it was a team effort. So like I said, it's been Yasmina, who's one of the pharmacists. She's developed the website for Green Health Wales. She's been doing a lot of work, and she just was presenting at a conference for pharmacy about the importance of, you know, decarbonisation, the environmental impact of pharmacy. So she's become a real leader. And then we've also got Gwen, who's another one of the junior doctors. She's a foundation doctor with me, and she's been a real, you know, key support and, you know, leading on it as well. So, yeah, and there's so many people that I could mention as well, though, you know. So it is, you know, it's created that sort of community. And I think you're coming back to this about the biggest opportunity. So I won't say anything more, but I
don't say that now. We'll come on to that. I just got one other part, and that's about how can we speed up the adoption and spread of your initiative? I know it's been spread across North Wales within your health board, but what's the one thing you think that might really spur this on?
Well, I think that anybody can, you know, take the initiative of, you know, starting what we've done. Like I've shown, it can be from, you know, from a very junior member of staff new to a hospital, or it can be anybody really, you know, whoever it is. So if you want to just reach out to us, and we can create a logo and a, you know, a green group, and just get you started really. But we're doing a webinar. So I think that's what's been good, is that we've had the opportunity to develop those skills, be able to support people in adopting and spreading scaling. So if people want to reach out to us, we can, and it's a struggle for us to fit in the time, but we're doing a webinar. So come along to that and we will help support you in developing.
Thanks, Tom. And really interesting, you know, it's about some of the tools, some of the work that we've been doing on adopt and spread for the last 2 years. We've been leading that program to try and understand what we can learn from a process of adoption. And what's become very clear is you need to be flexible and have adaptation in there. So it isn't just, here's the box, this is what you do. It's about actually saying, here's some tools, now go away and look at how you can best utilize them in your own environments, and how you can adapt them to fit your own needs, if you like, in that area. That's really interesting. Thanks, Tom. And I'm going to come on to Caitlin. Caitlin, you know, there's so much, I think, that we could learn from Scotland. It's like learning from each other. We still see that reluctance. I just wonder, really, how we might develop that sort of stronger cross-country links, really, to share that good practice and to ensure that we're not individually reinventing the wheel. We're building on each other's knowledge and expertise. How might we go about doing something like that?
Yeah, this is about community, isn't it? Absolutely. Every year until lockdown, we had a big health facilities conference up here. And I loved meeting, all the colleagues that used to come from NHS Wales, and just that meeting in person really helped to swap email addresses and have all these commitments about how we were going to work together. And then you get back to the office and you're suddenly into the day job again. So I think it's so crucial that someone mentioned in the chat about the networks. These networks are so important. And I suppose a silver lining of COVID is that we are finding it so much easier to connect. I think, well, I'm not alone in saying that I was not tech savvy at the beginning of this. And as much as we knew that we needed to be doing more online conferencing, there was still that draw to meeting in person. But now that we do have this and we are in this situation, I think it just provides an amazing opportunity environments, but beyond, I'm excited to hear about more of the work that's going on in NHS Wales. I'm finding it so inspiring. I loved that film at the start as well. I was singing along.
You mentioned COVID. You mentioned COVID, and I, Caitlin, and I'm just, has COVID reinforced the need for, solutions to the environment, or has it got in the way? And I'm just genuinely interested to understand what your views on that are, and whether there's something there for us to build on.
Gosh, yes. At the start of COVID, we had just had a big sustainability conference. It was attended by hundreds of people. We were so excited. We just declared a climate emergency. This was getting a high profile that it hadn't done for years. And we were about to launch our new strategy. And then COVID hit, and suddenly, obviously, all the effort and the priority became around that. But I do think in the longer term, it's really made people question generally. Stacey mentioned earlier about, and it's the same up here, it's still really surprising how much this is not common. It's not talked about, it's not discussed amongst all healthcare circles. As Tom mentioned too, when you start a conversation, there is a real willingness. We are pushing an open door. So I think that throughout COVID, these issues have become more talked about generally, that we are pushing an open door, but there's still a lot of work to be done in terms of just making this part of the mainstream conversation of what's happening.
Okay, yeah, really, really interesting, and absolutely right. And I just wonder whether we've got COP26 coming up. We're all looking at actions and various things. And I just wonder whether there's, an opportunity to kind of bring all this together in some shape or form, to do that individually, but also something combined there. But, let's go back and think about that. There's not much time left for that anyway. But I've got a question here from Madeline, really, which is about enabling action, really, to sustain the practice. I'm just really interested, really. I'm going to go back to Stacey on this one and ask you really about how do we engage other sectors into that cross-sector approach, from a health perspective. So, it's not just, of course, we know it's not just the health sector, but how do we do that? How might we do that, Stacey?
Thank you, Helen. So this is, I've only recently started the job, but this has been something that I've been trying to work out for myself more recently. So systems convening and trying to look at what's happening in other sectors and bring it into what we do in the NHS. And so, for example, when it comes to food, there's a lot of great work that's happening around sustainable food. And I feel that we can, use the what's going on in that sector and bring that into our food system in hospitals, so that we can have sustainable food that is locally produced and you know is sort of almost you know, if we can do it right in hospitals, then I feel like we can do it right in the rest of the population. And I think it's about getting everyone around the same table, really, and trying to create opportunities for that. So as part of our work with Green Health Wales, it's been around getting different parties together. And I think that'll be a big part of the work with the decarbonisation programme board as well. That's only kind of just started, but that will be definitely one of my priorities that I'll be asking for, is that we involve other sectors so that we can, you know, have a shared vision, because we're all interconnected. All of this is, you know, we're not in our own silos, it's all interconnected, you know, food, transport, energy, and I think it has to come from Welsh Government too. So one of our priorities that we put to them, to the Welsh Government, was that health should be in, you know, all of the other policies. So we wrote to the climate change minister and asked, you know, and it should be go right through. So then, you know, health becomes the, you know, at the forefront, and that's our goal.
So forward. Thank you for that, and it is fascinating, isn't it? And you know, yeah, we struggle with priorities, I suspect, in Wales, as anywhere else. So the minute something becomes a priority, something else doesn't become a priority, and the issue around what's the biggest priority? Is it the backlog? Is it, you know, the other challenges we have from COVID? What is it, and how can we actually try and bring all this together so it doesn't confuse everyone and we're not going from one priority to another? So this is a real challenge, I think. And I think it stems back to Joe's question, and I'm going to come back to Tom and ask Tom, and I'll come back to you also, Stacey, on this one, because it's to do with Wales. And her question was, how do we start to think more holistically about health services in Wales? How do we wrap greener Wales into one, and don't forget, we know that is value-based, outcomes-focused, co-produced, and of course, prudence. So for me, you know, I'm listening to all of you this morning, and the principles of prudence are fundamental. You know, that co-production, that, you know, greatest need first, using all skills and resources to best effect, doing only what's needed, no harm, and using evidence. You know, those are four fundamental principles. And, you know, we asked Don Bewick to validate, look back and say, were they still valid in light of COVID? And his answer came back saying they're even more valid now in light of COVID. So it's kind of, you know, we get a bit confused with these different things. How might we do it to wrap this together so they're not always seen as, what are we got to do, being a bit of that, bit of that, bit of that? How do we do that? Tom, I'm going to come to you first for this one, and then I'll come back to Stacey.
Yeah, so the prudent principles of healthcare is fundamental, I think, to our response to the climate emergency, and I think in the same way to COVID as well. But in terms of trying to think what the priorities are in our response, you know, value-based healthcare, co-production, all of those things, you know, those can be integrated into how we respond to this. And I think that that's should be a priority, is actually learning from all of the, you know, all of the good work that's happened already in Wales and integrating that into our response to the climate emergency. So I think that, you know, that should be fundamental, really, and that, you know, they're not really about going in different directions. They're all about trying to work together in the same direction, I think. And, you know, I'm sure that a lot of the Bevan Exemplar projects that weren't aimed at being for sustainability will have loads of sustainability benefits.
Yeah, absolutely.
Because, and I think, you know, if people looking at value-based healthcare, I think looking at what patients want, then, you know, that's going to empower them, that's going to help. So all of those things, you know, should be really important.
Thanks for that. Yeah, thanks. And Stacey, do you have something to add to that? How do we wrap all this together? Yeah, which wrapper does it have? Does it have a green wrapper, a prudent wrapper, a value wrapper? Many wrappers here.
So I think Tom answered the question, really. That sustainable healthcare, it does encompass all of these food and healthcare principles, value-based healthcare. We are all singing from the same hymn sheet. And I think it's just about bringing that forward in a structured way so that people know that they're doing, or that this is what they're doing, and they are able to measure it as well. Because we're very used to measuring the financial impact of things. But sustainable healthcare is all about redefining that value and defining it as a sustainable value. So having the outcomes of patients as a priority, but trying to reduce the environmental impact, increase the social value, and reducing financial impact. So it really does encompass it all, as well as the prudent health principles as well.
Absolutely. I'm going to come back to Caitlin on that one, because interestingly, she highlighted that green issues, the environmental issues, the sustainability issues were embedded into the performance management of NHS Scotland. Can you just unpack that a little bit? Because, the minute you're being, performance managed on something, it shoots up as a priority. Can you just unpack how that's working? What and give us an insight into that, Caitlin?
Yeah, that has made a big difference. Actually, it was in 2019 when Scottish Government signed up to delivering the UN Sustainable Development Goals. And so there was a lot of discussion at the time about how we embed this, about how can we translate something that's global, that's quite high level goals, into something that's going to work locally. And the National Performance Framework is something that we, in the NHS, in every business case that we make, we need to demonstrate how we are linking to those national outcomes and priorities. And so there are ones around equalities and health inequalities, around sustainability, obviously, around the use of resources, all aspects really of sustainability. So I think having it really embedded in that way, in a real way. We also, as part of our annual, this is just something that's specific to the NHS, we have a national sustainability assessment tool. And within that tool, it's a benchmarking tool that we initially, speaking of partnerships, we initially worked with NHS England to develop. And it's been modified now, as they call it up here, it's been tartanized. however, that tool...
It could be dragonized, actually. We could dragonize it.
It could be dragonized. That's perfect. and that tool covers all our areas of focus, and each health board reports on it. So as Stacey was saying, this is about valuing things differently, about measuring things differently, but they all link to the national outcomes. So when we are doing all these things, how is it linking to these national outcomes, and therefore how are we delivering on our commitment to delivering the UN Sustainable Development Goals?
Fantastic, and it just goes to show it's important to embed these kind of principles, this approach, into the main infrastructure of what we are doing and how we are working and holding people to account. So thank you for that, and I'm sure we will be looking to dragonize it in the coming months and years. So I'm going to thank you for that, and I'm going to come back, and you've got one last question. We've got just over 5 minutes left, and it was the question really around, what do you see as the major challenge, and what do you see as the major opportunity for really making this difference and achieving our goal of getting if you like that 2030, which what are we, 9-8 years away perhaps? How do you do that? So I'm going to come, sorry. I've got a dog who's trying to get out. How do we do that? I'm going to come first of all to Stacey, then to Tom, then to Caitlin. Just that, you know, what's that big thing we've got to get right? What's that big thing that's the barrier we've got to overcome? What's that real opportunity that we need to grab with both hands? So Stacey, over to you.
I think a big opportunity is that Wales is a very small country. And we are devolved, so we have, you know, we do have some control over this. And I feel, you know, I'm Welsh, and I feel a lot of pride for Wales. And I think we've got a lot of things right. You know, we've got the Future Generations Act, and if we can't do it, then I don't. How can anybody do it? You know, I think that's the biggest opportunity. And you know, we've seen how the NHS can change. As you know, I was in the healthcare service on the front line during the pandemic, and it was absolutely amazing to see how things just changed in the flick of a switch. And it was, and from this point of view, it's really given me hope that, you know, with the right momentum behind us, we can transform our healthcare service into one that is more sustainable. There's a lot of opportunity, a lot of hope to be had. And again, I think the main challenge is the resource and, you know, healthcare staff being already overstretched So for me as a healthcare professional, I often feel, you know, like we're firefighting. I've worked in the emergency department. We're service providing, but I feel that we need to give the opportunity to healthcare staff to have that bigger picture. To see, you know, have a longer term view of actually what the priorities are overall, and then, you know, we can move away from just firefighting and have a more of a long term structured plan going forward.
Thank you for that. And you know, I suppose I'm just going to come back slightly. The resource issue, is it about money or people? You know, we talk about our capacity to be able to manage in the wake of COVID, and you know, it's not just a question of turning on the tap for more staff because they're just not there. How do we do that in that, you know, with climate against that backdrop?
So we have to do it, don't we? I think what when you look at sustainable quality improvement projects, when people have done these projects, you will often notice that they are able to reduce the workload because they're delivering health in a different way. They're increasing, you know, the social value for the patients is better.
Yeah,
there is better for the environment, and people are the finance has gone down, but it's just about realizing that and harnessing that, and then hopefully, you know, you can with some extra resource. But you know, using it differently can transform the healthcare system so that, you know, with a similar amount of staffing, but perhaps using that differently, you're able to change the service. Great.
And that's exactly where we've been coming from a prudent perspective, is try to look at how we use things differently, how we do things differently. Okay, Tom, over to you. What's your big, you know, opportunity? What's your big challenge?
I think Stacey summed up the opportunities really well, but I think probably an underlooked opportunity is actually the staff well-being and having that sense of community, and actually being able to see that they're able to have that autonomy in their work to be able to deliver and make change. And I think that if we see that, we could probably see the capacity increasing because they've got more independence and control over what they do, and also can help with, you know, making Wales an attractive place for people to work, for retention of staff, for people to develop skills and expertise and leadership. So I think that might be we might underlook that. And I think that's, you know, is fundamental. And actually, because it's such a big employer, NHS Wales, the staff are going to be patients as well. So I think the co-production and, you know, thinking of the health of staff in partnership with the patients, because they, you know, people are overwhelmed still, from COVID. So we need to bear that in mind and think this is actually something that can improve staff wellbeing.
Your barrier?
The barrier, I think, is a practical one. And this is coming back to this, if we're looking at decarbonisation, because we've got a short target for this, but also if we look at the graph, which I know Stacey showed earlier, which is, you know, they call it sometimes like a hockey stick graph. And if you look, there's a lot of things we know we can do, which just requires a bit of leadership. Some things are out of our control. We have a bit of influence over that anyway, but that's, you know, but then at the bottom of the graph, there was this gap where we need research, innovation. So that's the bit that there's a lot of challenges, but that's going to be practically the biggest challenges to deliver on that.
Lovely. Thank you very much. And Caitlin, back to you. What do you see as a big opportunity and what do you see as the biggest barrier?
Oh, gosh. Well, the biggest barrier is how we scale up. There are so many pockets of amazing practice and always led by passionate staff that are doing it in their own time. We've got green theatre projects up here and it absolutely amazes me all the time at how much energy outside of the day job when they're already under a lot of pressure and stress. And it's how can we support them? How can we support those amazing things that are going on that are being led often by GPs, by nurses, by theatre staff, and making it an environment where they're really supported to do that and to spread that. And this is going back to what we said about networks, isn't it? To really be in a place where we're sharing that good practice and that others feel confident and supported to do it. And we're looking a lot at the moment around developing sort of climate literacy modules, training, so that people feel really confident and comfortable talking about these things. And we're also looking at how we can embed this into training as well for clinical staff.
So there's some great opportunities there around the tools, the literacy, the networks and embedding it in. So thank you very much for that. And can I thank you on behalf of, you know, everyone here today? Thank you all for putting so much time and effort into your presentations. Thank you all for giving us your time today. We know everybody is busy. I'm sure that everybody here has you know, some, and the comments validated, an absolutely superb, inspiring day, listening to you. And can I thank you on behalf of the Bevan Commission as well, say thank you all very much. And can I just encourage you to keep going? Lots of challenges, lots of opportunities, and no doubt we'll be back in touch. Thank you very much, everyone, and thank you for those of you who also are listening today. Thank you very much.